today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Welcome to campus and the World University Championships in Orienteering. We're with the university world's best rowers in northern France. And we meet the man who says he's the sole representative of an entire continent. It's all coming up in this edition of Campus. We start with the 19th World University Orienteering Championships in the Czech Republic. Orienteering is a fascinating combination of physical activity and mental agility, a sport practiced by more than 250,000 students.
The sport of orienteering for me is the experience of actually racing somewhere where I'm the person having to get myself there. So it's different from cross country where you can visualize the whole course, you know exactly where you're going. To me, it's me. I have to find my way.
The first rules date from 1900. Since then, the sport has slowly developed, especially in schools and universities.
I think this, that you have to have a high intellectual capacity at the same time as you are forcing your body to stress and other things are really showing that this is a good sport for high educated people. And I think from a physique point of view, it's really stressing the importance of a healthy body and a healthy soul.
These University World Championships have attracted more than 320 competitors from 32 countries.
Some of the best people in the world are here, and it's a unique opportunity to compete with some of the best people, very motivational to be a part of.
The competition is run under the auspices of FISU, the International Federation of University Sports, and everybody has to be checked in before they're allowed to compete.
According to the FISU rules, all the participants must be students between 17 and 28 years old, and I'm representing International Control Commission to check all the documents and to approve the participants to be real athletes during the competition.
The first World University Orienteering Championships took place in Finland in 1978. Since then, the numbers taking part have grown and so have the number of disciplines within the sport.
We have five types of courses. The oldest one is the classic distance. It's a long distance race and the classical gender separate relay. In this relay, there is the running three men together and in each team, and also the three women together in each team. And there is the next discipline is short distance race. It's most technical discipline from this four, and the youngest is the sprint. The winning time is between 12 and 15 minutes, and the absolutely new discipline is included to the program of the World University Championship is the sprint mixed relay.
The origins of orienteering go way back to the 19th century. It evolved as an offshoot of cross-country skiing in Sweden and was used mainly for military purposes.
Orienteering is known from Nordic countries, Norway, Sweden, Finland, with a really great tradition, but also Central Europe, like Switzerland and Czech Republic, or former Czechoslovakia, has a big tradition in this sport, and Czechs are also good organizers, not only runners, and they organized many world events. In 2008, it was held world championships here in Olomouc area.
Olomouc is in Moravia, in the east of the Czech Republic. The university plays an important role in the life of the city with over 25,200 students. Right now on the Neredin campus, there are also students from all over the world preparing for their races.
It's also my biggest goal this year, and it gives me experience for future challenges.
Frédéric Tranchant has already achieved his goal. The French orienteer has won the tough long-distance race here, ahead of two Swiss brothers, Matthias and Andreas Kibbutz. Orienteering is Frédéric's passion.
C'est la tête et les jambes.
It's in the head and the legs. It's not sufficient simply to run. You have to be able to read a card in order to identify the best choice of your route. That helps you to cut your time, and you must also be able to execute your plan to find the markers. It's a known orienteering area, but then you have to use the card. A card you haven't seen before the race. And as far as the route is concerned, it's always an unknown route. Even if you train with similar cards, the route changes every time. The 26-year-old Frenchman has only just finished his studies in civil engineering in Lyon and still qualifies to take part here. He now lives and works in Finland and he's ready for his next race, the sprint. I'll try to run the same race as yesterday. Because it's the sprint, you have a tendency to rush, to go too fast. But I want to take my time to choose the best paths and then negotiate them as well as possible. Tranchant, the sprint bronze medalist at the World Championships in 2010, knows he has some tough opponents here. There's a guy from Switzerland, his name is Martin Hubmann, who didn't race yesterday, and I think he's going to be fresh for sure. He's already won medals at the European Championships. He was third this year. He's a really strong opponent. The sprint course is situated in the city of Svatikopacek. Part of it actually runs through the local zoo. The terrain is very hilly, with forest tracks before they reach the asphalt of the city.
It's
certainly going to be a very varied race, and that'll make the competition difficult because normally we're used to running only in a city or in a park, and that's quite easy. But for this one, we have to adapt technically because we'll pass from a zoo to a forest and then into the city.
Man geht nochmals sehr seine Zielsetzungen durch. Was nimmt man sich vor für den Lauf?
Mentally, I'm going through my goals now, what I have to achieve, what I have to do, with very specific aims. And then, in the final hour, you have to warm up, and you have to try to get yourself into your best possible condition and push yourself. Martin Hubmann, the sprint bronze medalist at the European Championship, is fully focused, while Frédéric Tranchant looks rather more relaxed. Well, I know I'm in good shape, but the victory will be decided by the technical aspect around the course. As usual, that'll also be my focus. So Tranchant, all ready then for the sprint, the bronze medalist of the World Championship in 2010, the senior World Championship that was. And here, in the University World, is running a fast race, but he hesitates at the last control. It's a very physically demanding competition, this, and in the end, a decent performance, third place for Tranchant. The fight for gold, though extraordinary. Matthias Kibbutz starting earlier than his biggest rivals, setting the time to beat, and later his Swiss teammate, defending champion Martin Hubmann, crossing the finish line in exactly the same time. 2.5 kilometers, 17 control points, 14 minutes, 13.8 seconds the time. Two golds for Switzerland. 3 seconds ahead of Tranchant for France. The Swiss, satisfied with their performance. My fresh legs certainly helped me. Of course, I had to produce a good run right until the finish. I can only remember one situation where I was a little bit uncertain and I had to rethink the route. But you know, overall, I think I performed really very well.
Und hinstehen musste und sonst lief es super den ganzen Lauf. Werde sicher super glücklich sein über die.
I'm really happy about my medals, but for me, it's not only the result that counts. It's also the way I achieved it. When you've already won a real world championship medal, then you have to win a medal here as well. Trasha, also pretty satisfied. Well, I remember a physically hard sprint race, but I'm really happy that I was part of it, and I'll leave the event with a big smile. In the women's race, Caroline Olsen would get the gold medal for Sweden. By the finish, the gap to second place was nearly 20 seconds.
I think it's to be really, really calm in the beginning and use the compass a lot and not run too fast. Even if I think you can run really fast in this terrain, but it's so easy to do mistakes. So be calm in the head and fast in the legs.
The middle distance race is held in Protivanov. Typical continental terrain, very green, just right for a man like Martin Hubman. Norway's Gorel Running Sund was the winner of the women's long distance race, and she's the favorite for another gold medal here.
It's going to be a totally different race, much more technically demanding. So I have to just be really concentrated and at that race.
The defending champion, Lillian Forsgren from Sweden, disappointed with her performance. Only 24th, nearly 4 minutes behind the winner.
I don't think the weather did so much difference, but of course it was rainy when I ran, and in the beginning it was sunny, but I did two quite stupid mistakes where I ran too far and didn't see the control, and I lost almost as much as I am behind right now. So
another medal has to be shared by two runners, this time the bronze, won jointly by Lea Versalotti of France and Goro Running Sun from Norway, 54 seconds behind the winner. Iveta Sitskova gives everything to claim the silver medal for the Czechs, 48 seconds off the winning time. Meanwhile, Martin Hubman can't deal with the difficult conditions and only comes ninth, 1 minute, 29 seconds behind the winner. For Serena Jentzer, the women's race is almost a walkover. The Swiss runner completing the 5.4 kilometers and its 22 control points in 30 minutes, 48 seconds. Yesterday, I didn't have as good a sprint race as I expected, so I really focused today, especially on the start phase. I really tried to stay calm and concentrated, to completely control the start. I think that was very important for the whole competition, and I got that right. So after that, I had the necessary calm and self-confidence during my whole race. Her boyfriend, Matthias Kierbutz, proud of her performance. Albin Riedefeld from Sweden is the best of the men over 6.9 kilometers with 26 control points in 31 minutes 44 seconds, beating all the challengers by a comfortable margin of 36 seconds.
I think I had a good tactic. I felt like pushing hard in the beginning in the open forest, and then I tried to be really focused in the end when it was green and really hard, bad visibility. So I had good orienteering all the way.
The Swede congratulated by his teammates. The silver medal going to Luca Basse of France. With the early starter, Jan Petrzela from the Czech Republic, taking the bronze.
The championship was really extremely high quality in organizing, but also in the performances we saw here, because a lot of world and European champions took part. And I think we had a wonderful event here with high competition, but also with socializing and nice side events.
Overall, it was the Swiss who came out on top with 9 medals, including 4 golds, ahead of Sweden, winners of the men's and women's relays with a total of 5 medals, and France with 4. The championships demonstrating that FISU is on the right track in promoting the sport of orienteering. Coming up on campus, we're in France for the University Rowing Championships. And we'll hear from the young man trying to put African rowing on the world map, right after the break, when campus returns.
Quand la culture et l'éducation se lient au sport. Quel événement promeut l'excellence du corps et l'esprit? Où s'unissent amitié, intégrité et réussite? Quel événement rassemble les meilleurs athlètes étudiants du monde entier? Les Universiades, le sport universitaire international à son sommet. Star aujourd'hui, leader demain.
We're in northern France for the 13th World University Rowing Championships. The second time France has played host, but it's the first global event for the Gravelines Basin here, handily located near the border. I think that actually it's one of our assets to be located where we are, here, as close as we are to those countries with a strong tradition in rowing. Germany, England, Belgium, and slightly less Holland as well. Those are countries with a strong tradition in rowing. And word from the Sports International Federation. We all know how important our sport is for the academic community. It should be noted that in many countries there are many rowers in universities. It's a universal sport par excellence. So, for the International Rowing Federation, it's very important to support what's going on here.
Un endroit obligé.
34 nations are taking part in the championships with nearly 500 athletes, a record. They've come from every continent, among them first-time countries like Morocco and Sri Lanka.
In our country, we started rowing after entering into our university. But here, most of the people have started rowing in their schools.
They
have been rowing for 6-7 years. And in our case, it's around 2 years. And it's kind of experiencing is also playing here. And that's the thing. They have more experience and they use these conditions. And there are the problems here.
13 competitions are on the program, the sculls, single, double and quadruple, where each rower has 2 oars, and 3 disciplines where the rowers have just 1 oar apiece, the eights and the cockless pairs and fours. The championships bring together many of the best rowers on the planet, like Simon Baylor, the Hungarian, who competed at the London Olympic Games.
Olympic is the highest level, so the university rowing is a little bit easier, but not easy. The pressure is always the same because we need to do 2,000 meters, so only the maximum. There are a lot of elite level of rowers, so near the same.
Eva Kapanen in the Finnish team carries the pressure of her father's name. Pertti Kapanen was a triple Olympic champion, one of the biggest names in world rowing.
I don't think that's that, because it's just my father. He's my father, not a great rower for me. Of course, I know that he used to be a great rower, and that's really good. But first of all, he's just my father. He said, just go hard and have fun. Enjoy the day, yeah.
As always, one country is under extra pressure in the World Championships, the organizing country. In this case, France.
Le premier objectif,
Our first goal was to get our seven boats here into the finals, so we've done the first part of our work. Secondly, we have to set an example because we're the host country. And then we've got the advantage of knowing the site. We've been able to row at a preview training camp before these World Championships, and so we've put ourselves in the best position to produce the best possible performance. Qualifying for the Coxless Fours, the Sri Lankans are up against the Russians, the Czechs, the Dutch, and the Chinese. That's tough.
In our country, we mostly use crocodiles. So basically, this is different from us. So it's difficult for us to balance the boat.
Yeah.
Because the water doesn't grip properly. So we did improve. We rode for like 3 days before, like three sessions before the regatta. We had a bit of time, but I don't think it was enough for us to adapt for this equipment.
Eva Karppinen is a specialist in the double sculls, but here she's competing in the singles, where her father made his name. Eva got through to the final, but she finishes behind Germany's Marie-Catherine Arnold.
It was a bit too windy for me. I had 20 times in a single this year, so... But yeah, I'm happy that I was in the final. The final could have been a lot better.
In the men's cockless pairs, the race is between Hungary and South Africa. The Hungarians tapping into their reserves to resist their main rivals. Simon Balaam is the university world champion.
In a sportsman's life, is one of the most important is the Olympic Games, but the same important is the medals from other very big races, so it's wonderful. It's one of the best feelings if I dream ever, so it's very good. It was a good race, very, very strong and good opponent, so it's wonderful.
13 competitions, 9 British boats in the finals and 4 victories so far. Great Britain remains a formidable power in the world of rowing, and the eights is the blue ribbon event of these championships. It's the boat that's used in the most famous race in the world, Oxford against Cambridge, won 3 times by Carl Hudspeth.
They're very different races, the Oxford Cambridge boat race and the FISU World Championships. The boat race is a long 4-mile race on a bendy river, and it's just a one-on-one race. Whereas out here, it's a 2K sprint and it's a multi-lane regatta. So we've got 6 crews in the final. It makes it a lot faster, a lot more furious. You've got to just go out as hard as you can and keep on going.
Up against Great Britain here, the strong eights of France and Canada. They will push the British to their limits. The final is tight all the way, but the British finally win.
It's a great event, and I'm very pleased to have won it. It's actually my second time at FISU, and it's also my second gold medal. And I'm very proud to be a champion at this event.
Behind Great Britain, France has achieved its goals. The balance sheet is more than positive. We have a new world title in the Coxless Fours in the lightweight division. It was expected a little bit, but until they crossed the line, it was still a bit uncertain. The women's four, that was gorgeous. Nothing else to say about it. And then the eight, finishing second behind the British boat. That, I think, well, we're not yet able to go and beat them. But we'll see you at the Universiade in Guangzhou, and we'll see what happens. I hope we can take a delegation as complete and competitive as this one, because, well, these guys deserve it. The next rowing university championships will be in Poznan in Poland in 2016. You're watching Campus, and still to come, the sole Moroccan rower on a mission. And we report on canoeing and squash in just a moment.
When education meets sport and culture, what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Meet Ali Abouelouafa, the first Moroccan to take part in the World University Rowing Championships. As usual, I've come alone to these championships because, in fact, there are just a very few of us who do rowing in Morocco. But I have the opportunity of training here in France, and that is why I've come to these World Championships at Gravelines. I graduated last year in Morocco, and I had a choice of staying in my country and continuing my studies, but stopping rowing, or living this adventure, both sporting and human, by continuing to practice rowing and getting a good academic degree. My day begins at 5:30 a.m. Wake up, 6:30 at the club. We train, 8 o'clock to the university until 6. And me, unluckily, I have to work after that to pay my way in life. I go to work, I get back home at 11. I revise my lessons quickly, go to bed, and go again. South Africa notwithstanding, Ali says he's the only rower to represent the African continent. South Africa is not Africa because they have a sports program like European countries. First of all, they don't take part in the African Championships. They make the World Championships directly because they have a very high standard. I would say Morocco is the representative of the whole of Africa, so I've got a lot of pressure on me here. A student in physical education at the University of Nantes, Ali's taking part in the single sculls with a boat he got here because he doesn't have the means to bring his own. It's a boat that was lent to me by the International Rowing Federation. Thanks to them, otherwise I couldn't participate in these championships. Those accustomed to their own boat are more likely to be a medalist or a world champion, of course, while we, who come from developing countries in rowing, always have to cope with boats that aren't ours. Fortunately, there are volunteers here to help us. For 3 days, I've been joined by a volunteer who's been doing her best to be there just when I need it. I'm a volunteer at the World Rowing Championships, and I've been given the mission of being an angel. An angel is somebody who provides information to some of the nations. Ali, well, when I saw that he was alone, not even with a coach or a representative, because I know rowing, and I said to myself, I've got to give him the maximum possible assistance. For example, for the adjustment of his boat, I've tried to find people, because there must be at least two or three people to adjust the boats, and after that, to encourage him in his race. Well, he's all alone, and sometimes that's difficult. So here's Ali in the C final of the University World Championships. Against him, an Austrian, a Norwegian, an Australian, an Italian, and a Malaysian. A difficult race for the Moroccan, and the conditions haven't really helped him. Yeah, the conditions are very difficult. There's a lot of crosswind, so it was hard for me to paddle in those conditions. Finally, I tried to hook up with the others, but I failed, really. And in the last 500 meters, I also had the jury boat waves against me. So it was difficult, and that's it. Nevertheless, the essentials remain. I'm really proud to be the representative of Morocco. I would have preferred it if there'd been more of us at these championships, but I'm the first, the pioneer, if you like, and I hope there'll be other Moroccan rowers to come. It's over. And I pay for one night more. The Sprint Canoeing World Championships have been taking place in Belarus. 22 countries and 250 athletes competing for 18 university world titles. The best of the kayakers, the Czech Josef Dostal, the winner over 200 and 500 meters. In canoeing, his compatriot Martin Fuchser was number one over 500 meters. And the big winner amongst the women, the Belarusian Marina Livinchuk, winning three golds over 500 meters. The top nation was Belarus, with 20 medals altogether, including 13 golds. And finally, word on the University World Championships in squash, held at Chennai in India. 12 nations taking part, with the women's gold returning to Britain and Camilla Tomlinson. While Egypt, a strong nation in university squash, won two world titles, the men's singles and the mixed team. And that was Campus, the program that puts the spotlight on university sport. Until next time.
Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
When education meets sport and culture, what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.